Hello, it's Sara, and today I want to talk to you guys about stained glass as a hobby, right? It isn't the least expensive hobby that you're going to invest in. So if you're really passionate about it and you want to get started, I just wanted to tell you, the basic tools that you'll need to get some stained glass pieces. So we're going to start at the very beginning. And to make a stained glass piece, which this is a basic panel, right? You're going to need quite a few supplies, right? So you're going to need the glass. And glass will run you anywhere from about $7.99 to $16, depending on the glass. I have been getting mine at Hobby Lobby, and you can get it on sale there. They have their coupons and they have their 40% off time, so go when it's on sale. So you're going to need something to cut the glass with, right? So first you decide what you want to make, right? So if you're going to do this panel, this is only two pieces of glass. Actually, no, it's three. The star and the moon are different glass. You can see this has like an iridescent coating to it, and this is just more of a sheer glass with some striations through it, and then the purple is actually iridized as well. So you're going to need three in this case, right? Now for these, this is just a, I was playing around, but this is scrap glass. So once you've been in it a while, you can always use your scraps and you get a little more freestyle, right? I've been creating my own patterns. So that's probably a pattern that was either in a book or online. I mean, there's patterns all over the place, but what I'm finding is I've started getting into creating my own designs, and I'm loving that. So this little castle I created myself. It's a little, maybe there's one, two, three colors of glass and the roof. So four colors of glass for this particular pattern, right? All I did was take a piece of graph paper, just like this one here. Well, not, this one's a little messy. And I just simply use these lines, these grid marks, to create my pattern. And when you do a nice straight line pattern like this, it's super simple. But I've even gotten into, now I'm doing these cats. So this is the updated version. I'm going to show you my two cats side by side. This is a little cat, and it's got flux all over it, but I designed this myself using a ruler and a pencil. So here's my cats. This is the first one I shared with you guys. He's a little more robotic looking, and I tweaked it a little bit, the design. And here's my little second cat. And I made this with Fran's colors. I think I'm going to do a walkthrough tutorial on the whole head for you guys. Because I tweaked it, I've changed it from the very first cat face I did to this one to this one. I haven't added whiskers or anything on him yet. And I was even thinking of adding a necklace or some type of beads. I'm not sure if I want it to be fancy, because I keep calling him a him. But I'm playing around with these ideas, right? So once you have your pattern, you need to make, copies of the pattern, the original pattern. Go to your copy machine, and I'm just looking for, here we go. And you're going to just, on copy paper, so here's my cat, get your pattern. So the first thing you want to do is cut out your pattern. And some people, listen, I'm telling you how I do it, but some people don't do this at all. They would take a clear piece of glass, like I have this right here. We're going to probably do a little yellow cat out of this. This was $7.99 at Hobby Lobby. And they might just take this and maybe a light box, and you could draw right on your glass. There's a lot of different ways you can do this. I like the paper template way. I just find it easy. I can think about, I don't know. Watch videos too. That's the thing, is all knowledge is good knowledge. You're going to be able to pick and choose what you like versus what they like. Just because they do it one way, you don't have to do it that way. There are lots of ways to skin a cat. But you need to get this pattern onto the glass in some way. And my way is to use these. These are called, let me see what these are called. These are called, I know what they're called and I have a list here. Hold on, where's my list? I may have to go away and come back till I find my list. I think they're called foil cutters. And what they are, it's three blades. So there's two blades on this side and there's one blade on this side. So you get a little smidge of paper, it creates a channel. So when I'm cutting this design, I'm going to create a channel. I'll show you what happens. I'm just going to cut right down one of these lines. Because it has those three blades, I know you can't see that, I get this little channel between. So what happens then when I foil my pieces, I have that leeway. I have that little bit of room between the pieces. It's important because if you go back to like my first video I did, I forgot all about these scissors. And I'll be right back. I'm going to find my list. I'll be right back. Okay, got my list. Foil pattern shears. So basically you're cutting your pattern with these. If it says foil shears or something like that, that's what it is. It has these two blades on one side and one on the other. So that is then, what I'm going to do is I'm going to cut all the pattern out. So I'm going to do this cat. I'm going to take you step by step through the process of me doing this cat. Now I've done, when I did the houses, I did this. So it's not, it's the same process, but I'm going to talk more about a little bit more about the tools. So could you do this without these? Sure you could. It's just, you just want to make sure when, because when you put the puzzle back together, once you've added your copper foil, this is what I mean by that. All your pieces, once you've cut your glass, so you have your glass, you cut it, and you're going to grind it. So I have a grinder. That's like another $100. So this is not a cheap, I do think they might have a hand grinder that you can like an emery board type thing. But you're going to grind down your pieces of your puzzle. I call it a puzzle, but it's, you know, your pattern pieces. I'm trying to find one that has a different shape. And all of these have been ground, and then you're going to add your copper foil. So every piece of the puzzle is going to be, have copper foil on it. And this is like around $6. And there's different types of copper foil, just because they have backing on them. So I have, right now I have one that is, this is just copper on both sides. And this one is black backed, because you can patina the solder to be whatever color foil. So if I'm gonna patina, like say that cat, I think I did that in copper. So I'm gonna patina him with the copper, I think. I don't remember. It's not that big a deal. I've used copper foil on, and then I patina whatever color I want. I mean, it's really, if you have clear glass and you can see through it, you can see the inside of the foil in there. So that's why they tint it different colors. So after you cut your pattern, you're going to glue all your the pieces that you want. So for this cat, say I'm going to do that cat. I cut out all those pieces and I'm going to glue them onto the glass color that I want to use. So I'm going to do this whole cat in this color. And really fancy artists, they'll only use a specific little piece right here that they love the swirl of it, or it works, like if you're making one with wind or something. And I don't get really that caught up in it. You know, I try to make it look consistent. That's what I've been trying to do. So you'll glue it, and I just use a glue stick, like I've been using this Ranger collage stick, and glue the paper on to the glass. And then that is your guide for when you cut the glass, all right? So then you're going to go down, well, I go down the basement. You're going to need a cutting surface. Now, I have like a grid. It's like a plastic grid thing that catches all the little shards of glass. You don't need that. Like, I could cut right here at my desk, But you need to have a dustpan, and make sure when you're done cutting, you clean up all those little shards of glass, because it will cut you, and it's dangerous, you know. Also use protective goggles if you like. I wear glasses, so I feel safe, but I'm not, and I know I'm a danger girl, so just FYI, use common sense, you know. So you're gonna cut your glass, and there's a couple things you can use to cut your glass. The way, and now all this is coming from my experience. So like I said, Google it, go to shops that offer supplies, and look into it more. If you are passionate about this craft, do some research about it, right? I'm just telling you what I have. This is called let me get my list, because I don't remember names. I don't know. A pistol grip cutter, hence the shape, right? And I put my little finger on it, and I'll run it across the glass like that to cut. You do need cutting oil as well, which I have this cutting oil, and this has lasted me. I've never replaced this, and you just put a little bit on a sponge and roll it. Make sure your blade is lubricated. This has lasted me a long time too. I might get this other type of cutter. There's this other type of cutter, this one. It's just called glass cutter, and the blade is here on this end. And then this little ball, and it's metal, it's heavy. You would take that little ball and tap, so you make your score line, and then you tap the glass with that ball, and it breaks the glass. And I think that's probably a really cheap, easy way to go, because I bought all my stuff at a shop who wanted to sell me stuff, so they probably sold this to me thinking, but they might like it too, who knows. I like it. I have nothing bad to say about it, but it might be worth it to try that if it's $250. So you try to go as close to your line of your cutting, and I'm going to do a cutting video more specific to talk more about what you should do and what you shouldn't do, right? But you're going to want to cut all your pieces out, and you're going to want to grind them down, right? All right, I'll do another cutting video. Yeah, so you're going to grind them all down and cover each piece of the puzzle, so this little cat here, with the copper foil tape, and then put it all in position. Now, there's something called layout pins, right? And that's what these are. They're kind of grungy, but they're like tacks, but they have a really long... And they're I think they're a specific kind of metal too, and they come with the kind I got came with this it's like a block system, because if you have a straight line, I line this up with one of the lines on the grid of the graph paper, and you know that you have a straight line at the bottom. And then like for my castle, that's what I did. So I put this down, and then you put this down, and you know you're straight on the bottom. You can also put a piece of came, which is like a U channel. It's shaped like a U, like this, and the glass fits right into it along the bottom. So you can disguise if it's not perfect, and it gives it stability too. So that's another option. But for me, for making these little wind catchers, I've been just, I haven't been using the came. Came is this stuff. Look, I'll show you. It's on here. So it's this piece here. It's like a separate piece that you can put on all the edges, and it just makes this totally solid. Now this is not going anywhere. Like, you know, these joints, if I bend like that, I can break it, you know. I mean, there's really nothing solid keeping this together. It's just the solder, so you really have to be gentle with it, you know. So when you add the came, you're making a much more sturdy piece, and it's a good thing to get. So you're going to definitely need this type of stuff. So you would set this up like this and get yourself a T square, you know, and make sure you're straight, and then you're good. Then you could just, like for the other two sides, you could just put a pin on each piece of glass like that. So a piece at the white, a piece at the blue, and it would pretty much hold it in. But you could just use four pieces of this, you know, but that would hold your piece in. And then once you tack solder all your pieces together, you can take all this away, and it's easy to just solder without all this in your way, you know. So you're going to need some of these. These are important because I'll tell you, I was very frustrated with my cat. My cat, I tried to do it because I've been watching Maria. I can't think of her channel, but she's a very quick and easy type stained glass pieces. But I had a hard time with him because his head really didn't have anything to hold him together. And because I put these eyes in there, like you can kind of tell, this is off. It's not perfectly straight on the side. So like if I would have put those straight bars here, maybe that would have helped me more. I don't know. But I just lined my eyes up and I don't think anybody's really going to be able to tell, you know. But those pins just helped me because when I went to flux it, which I'm going to talk about in a minute, I kept moving the top, the pieces, and it was just getting on my nerves. But he turned out cute. All right, so then you've got all your pieces cut and foiled and tacked down and they're in place. The next thing you want to do is flux. And flux is this, and I like to use this gel flux, and I have about like this much left. It's 8 ounces, and I've had this forever. Quick soldering on copper foil, lead, or zinc came. No mess, gel, no odor, no smoke. It's by Classic 100, but I like it because it doesn't spill. So if I put it in this little jar, it's not going to, like a liquid would. It kind of, you know, gives me a minute. And it doesn't spatter or splash as much. I just like it. So you're going to coat your foil joints, and anywhere you're going to put solder has to have flux to conduct the heat or something. You're going to need a soldering iron, which I have this Weller SPG80L, and maybe I'll do a separate video about the different soldering irons, but basically this one you could look up on Amazon, and I think they might even sell this at Hobby Lobby. Hobby Lobby is the only craft store, by the way, in like locally that sells this type of stuff besides a stained glass specific store. But you can get a good soldering iron, you can get glass, you can get solder, you can get flux. I think they sell actually a paste flux. I'm not sure. And you can use coupons. And you can get this stand, which mine is grungy, but it's very good to have a stand because the sucker gets hot, so you're going to need a stand. This is an old piece of salmoniac block that I tried to get out, and it's grungy, so I would get a new one of these eventually. But you need a stand. Speaking of a salmoniac block, it's called sal ammoniac block, so it's ammonia. And this was actually recommended to me by the second place I found, and it's Rabicoon Productions on YouTube. He does videos, and I forget his name, but he has a shop, and he really recommends this, and it's to keep your soldering iron tinned and clean. And when you tin it, I'm just coating the tip of this with solder, and then you just leave it to, and it gets dry and hardens, but I don't know. It's supposed to be better for it, and so I've always just used it, so that's what I know. So, I mean, a lot of people just use a sponge, which I use both, because if it just looks like it's getting dirty, like there's buildup. Buildup happens because of the flux, and the flux burns and different stuff. I'll just I wet this first and wipe it on the wet sponge. And I've seen videos where people just use the sponge. They don't use a salmoniac block at all. So there's a lot of options. That's just how I do it, and it's because I was taught that way, and I do it that way. Now, I also have this Hakko, I can't get it, this guy, remember? I just bought this, a smoke absorber, and I just ordered more filters because, you know, that's ammonia. I mean, it's chemicals. The lead, there's lead in the solder and all that stuff, so the fumes get sucked right into here. It's a fan, and so I feel better about doing that up here because I'm in the house. It's not ventilated, it's winter, and so I've been using this, and I'm very happy that one of you guys suggested me do that, and I did it. So listen, as a hobby, as a just try it type thing, this isn't something that you really just want to, like I would do, just try it for kicks and giggles or whatever people say, right? I've done this a lot. I have tons of stained glass all over my house. I have
I have probably a sun catcher in pretty much every window. I've sold the pieces before. Now I'm getting back into it and I'm creating my own designs. So it is something that you would really want to put some time and effort into, and you're definitely going to put some money into, because these products, like even just to buy the flux and this, it's $10 each, and then the grinder downstairs, that's a whole nother thing. That's like $100. You know, this filter thing I think was around $70 or $80. So, you know, it's an investment. And so if you're thinking about it and you're really serious about it, maybe take your time. You don't have to get everything all at once. Use coupons. Go to eBay. See if they have kits that you can get. And try it, because it's very cool. And now that I've just relaxed and, you know, realized that there's so much you can do with your own imagination, I still have a lot to learn, believe me. And I think that's great, because I go away and come back to so many different crafts. I'll go away and I'll forget the names of all this stuff again, and I'll have to relearn it, you know. Well, that's me, because my brain, I have no hard drive and hard copy or whatever in my brain. But like then, yeah, like I said, I just started taking these scraps and making little freeform designs, which was so fun. I'm adding the wire and everything to stuff now. Like I said, on the cat, I was even thinking of stringing some of these gorgeous stones, or whatever these are. They're not Swarovski. They're just glass beads onto wire and making a little collar for my cat or something. I'm really enjoying combining different mediums, and mixed media is just like everything now. So I'm just thrilled where this went from, for me, the traditional kind of doing a panel to just put glass together and put color together and have fun. Like, see, I've done this. I've shown you guys a lot of this stuff. This is a little card holder. I have toothpicks in there. This little box. I mean, you can get this stuff in kits. You know, you can get the patterns probably and a kit for this. There may be glass shops that sell the kit that would give you the glass that you need, the pattern, and all that stuff. So look around and maybe you can start out that way. But if not, you can get one piece of glass. Like, the next thing I'm going to do is just walk you through the complete making of this cat. And maybe I'll make, see, I don't know if I can, because I saw this cat on Etsy, a very similar design, because it's obviously, it's not, I'll have to look back and see what it was, because I created it, you know what I mean? Like, I drew it on here, so it's obviously mine, but I did see a very similar cat. So I don't know if I could sell that or anything. Maybe I'll just put it for free. I'll put it for free. I don't know if I can do that either. But it is simple to do. I'll teach you how I did it. How about that? I'll teach you how I drew it, and then you guys can draw your own, and you can tweak it and change it and make it your own style cat, you know? So I'm planning on doing that, because I've gotten a lot of questions about, you don't mind that I switch it up so much, but when I do this, you don't know enough about it. So I'm just trying to give you the basics of what I know, so you can kind of follow along a little easier. So basically, then once you've soldered everything, you flux it and you solder, and I'll go into the steps of soldering, the different types of solder, because solder is, it comes, right now I'm using two types of solder, which is the 50-50, which is 50% tin, 50% lead, and the 60-40, which is 60% tin and 40% lead. And I don't really know why that's the case, like the science behind that. So I, like I said, or I've heard it before, but I don't pay attention. I just, you know, so you need to get that. That's $15. It lasts a pretty long time though. Running out of 60-40. So you're gonna solder everything, clean it up, gotta add your hangers, and then you can patina the solder if you want to. Like I said, if you have the copper backed foil or the black backed foil, you would use a patina, which is in a box over there. And I did a video on that. So you just take a cloth and you rub this solution over your solder, and it changes the color. Like, this is done in the copper color, so you can see. So this is silver, this is copper, and then this panel I did with either black, or I have this other color called charcoal, I think, or granite, graphite. So I think this is black though, so you can see the difference. And it makes a difference with the piece. So depending, if you're using like pinks and stuff, you might want to bring, you know, use the copper because it's like pink gold almost. And I think the silver always looks bright and shiny. And then this just looks traditional to have the black. So pretty much then you're done. I have used polish too. There's like a compound that you can rub on it afterward to kind of a finishing compound. And that's it. You know, and then you need these little guys to hang it on the window, or we've added chain to the pieces and put a little cup hook at the top of the sill, and you can hang it with chain if it's a really big piece. But for these little guys, it's super easy, and it's pretty satisfying, and I love color, and it's just, it's fun. So I hope that was helpful. So like I said, I'm gonna come back and do a few more videos on stained glass for you guys that just get a little more in depth on specifics behind, say, pattern making, cutting the glass, and then soldering, you know, and then finishing. So maybe a four-part series I'll do. But this was just kind of an overview of start to finish, okay? So I hope that was helpful. Thanks for watching.